is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Romans 8, 1.
Okay, y'all sit back down. Can I get a volunteer to read what is Celebrate Recovery?
Celebrate Recovery is a Christ-centered 12-step program that will also teach us eight principles found in the Beatitudes of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. This is a working discipleship program for our lives. The focus of the group is to deepen our relationship with Christ, or for you to be introduced to Christ. Then we take an inventory of our lives and confess to God and to another human being the exact nature of our wrong. We humbly ask God to remove our character defects so we can make amends for restitution that so we have earned. Except we do so with any of them or others, and also forgive those who have hurt us. Then we continue to process through prayer and meditation to know God's will for us and the power to carry it out. With this spiritual awakening, we now carry this good news to others and practice these principles in all of us. This becomes a new pattern of living.
That's right. So when they over in church on Sundays, you'll hear them talk about making disciples and discipling others. This is the recipe right here, and it's the steps that are in that process. All right, so tonight is a lesson night, so we're going to go over the 12 steps and their biblical comparisons, as well as the eight principles and the Beatitudes that are attached to those principles. So what we'll do is I'll start, and then we're just going to zigzag back and forth. Everybody gets an opportunity to read. If you do not want to read, just say pass, so the person next to you knows that it's their turn. And then when we do the principles, the Beatitudes are in red. So the Beatitudes, we'll read those together as a word. So, step one, we admitted we were powerless over our addictions and compulsive behaviors, that our lives had become unmanageable.
I know that nothing good lives in me. That is my sinful nature, for I have a desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. Romans 7:18.
Or realize I'm not God. I admit that I'm powerless to control my tendency to do the wrong thing, and that my life is unmanageable.
Happy are those who know they are spiritually poor. Matthew 5:3.
Step two, we came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to heaven.
For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose. Philippians 2:13.
He earnestly believed that God exists, that I matter to him, and that he has the power to help me recover.
By the way, those big capital letters, the reason why we're saying them is because that will spell recovery.
Happy are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Matthew 5:4.
Step three, we made a decision to turn our wills and our lives over to the care of God.
Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Romans 12.
C. Consciously choose to commit all my life and will to Christ's care and control.
Happy are the meek. Matthew 5:5.
Step four, we made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves.
Let us examine our ways and test them, and let us return to the Lord. Lamentations 3:40.
Openly examine and confess my faults to myself, to God, and to someone I trust.
Happy are the pure in heart. Matthew 5:8.
Step five, we admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs.
Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. James 5:16.
Step six, we were entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character.
Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will lift you up. James 4:10. voluntarily submit to every change God wants to make in my life and humbly to ask Him to remove my character defects.
Happy are those whose greatest desire is to do what God requires. Matthew 5:6.
Step 7, we humbly ask Him to remove all our shortcomings.
If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9.
Step 8, we made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all.
Do to others as you would have them do to you. Luke 6:30.
E, evaluate all my relationships. Offer forgiveness to those who have hurt me and make amends for harms I've done to others, except when to do so would harm them or others.
Happy are the merciful, Matthew 5:7. Happy are the peacemakers, Matthew 5:9.
Step 9, we made direct amends to such people whenever, whenever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others.
Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to them and then come and offer your gift. Matthew 5:23-24.
Step 10, we continue to take personal inventory and when we were wrong, promptly admit it.
So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you do not fall. 1 Corinthians 10:12.
R, reserve a daily time with God for self-examination, Bible reading, and prayer in order to know God and His will for my life and to gain the power to follow His will.
Happy are those who celebrate recovery.
Woo-hoo! Yeah. We saw prayer and meditations improve our conscious contact with God. Praying only for knowledge of His will for us and power to carry that out.
Let the message of Christ dwell in you richly. Colossians 3:16.
Step 12, having had a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, we try to carry this message to others and to practice these principles in all our affairs.
Sisters and brothers, if someone is caught in a sin, you who are spiritual, restore him gently. But watch yourself, or you also may be tempted. Galatians 6:1.
Yield myself to God to be used to bring this good news to others, both by my example and by my words.
Happy are those who are persecuted because they do what God requires. Matthew 5:10.
All right, so we're going to pass the basket around. If you can afford to donate, that's good. If you can't, that's okay too. This just kind of offsets some of the cost of the stuff and food, etc. And
hey everybody, my name's Chris. Hey Chris. I am a super grateful believer. I struggle with pornography and masturbating and video games and other ways to escape facing life. Today is day 254. We're going to read right here. It's titled The Dentist. Jeremiah 6:14 says, you can't heal a wound by saying it isn't there. I hate going to the dentist. I mean, really hate it. What I hate the most is the lecture. It's the one where the hygienist tells me how I haven't been brushing right and asks if I even bother to floss at all. She reminds me, with a note of compensation, brushing circles, not back and forth, and shaking her head as though the entire discussion is hopeless indeed. She tells me that as long as I refuse to follow these guidelines for good oral health, I'll keep doing it. No wonder I put off my last visit until I was in pain. I mean bad pain. Even then, I tried all these things first, hoping to take care of the problem myself. Did a handful of ibuprofen. I did herbal remedies. I toughed it out. I'll tell myself I'm a man. Woo! I can handle it. Eventually, though, I had to go to the dentist. Had I gone when the tooth first began to bother me, I would have had to endure an uncomfortable morning of drilling and filing, yes, and the annoying lecture. But because I put it off, I had to endure the drilling a root canal, an annoying lecture, and a huge dental bill. It never pays to put things off, pretending everything is going to be fine. That just makes matters worse. It's much better to face up to things and let God help us get them taken care of. So pray with me tonight, guys. Thank you, Father, for helping me face the difficulties in my life so that you can help me take care of them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Okay, I'm going to... So before Al comes up and shares the lesson with us tonight, this is Al's last night here with us. He's retired and he's going to California for... I don't have any idea why anybody would go to California. But he's going. So when he came through our doors about a year ago, a little over a year ago, I thought they were sending a spy to come check us out because he came from Saddleback Church where the Celebrate Recovery started. And I'm a rule bender, if not just outright break the rules. I felt like God put him in our life because we got some experience that you can only get at Saddleback. And so I kind of don't really want to introduce him for the last time, but I will. So he has been an intricate part of this group. He stepped into leadership before that. His first meeting was even over. Because I asked him, I handed him a badge that I want you on my leadership team. And it's with a heavy heart that we have to say goodbye to him tonight. But I'm super grateful for the insight and the rules and all that stuff that he brought to us that really kind of helped us straighten out a couple of things that, that could use some attention. So, Al, come on.
Hawaiians are emotional. And so if I choke up on a couple of things, it's because it's sincere. It really is sincere. So part of my testimony will change. I've been in Celebrate Recovery now 12 years. Took my tenure chip because technically you're supposed to take a chip after you do it, your first 12 step. Took 2 years to complete a 12 step, just so you know. Just want to let you know that God has a purpose for us all, for everything. Don't think just because you just started with Celebrate Recovery or you're just on your journey now, or you've been at it like me for a while. I've had, my sponsor is 30 years plus in recovery. He started with AA and then with Celebrate Recovery kicked in because it's not quite 30 years. he kind of told me, take a day at a time in a moment. That is really, really good. So here's the brief testimony. I took the job at North Topsail, and when I took it, I literally was after about 6 o'clock, drove up here through the island and up on 50, and I said, Lord, I really would like to be part of a Celebrate Recovery. Would you please lead me to one? Honestly, goodness, can't make this stuff up. Passed by Providence, Baptist Church, and there's the sign. Celebrate Recovery meets. I said, really, Lord? Take my phone out. Don't do this. But I text. I Googled the number, and as I'm driving, I left a message on the recording message. Said, my name's Al. Listen, I've been part of Saddleback CR. I'd love to be part of this CR. Whatever you need, please let the ministry leader know. And I still have it. I'll probably have it for the rest of my life on my phone until something happens. Doesn't. I have Jingles, long drawn out message that he called back. And he's got a distinct voice, right? So it was just so great. He's right. By the time I finished at the end of our first meeting coming, which was the next week, he said, not that you have a choice, but you're one of my leaders, okay? I said, all right. And so it's been wonderful, Jimbo, and Ms. Vicki, thank you. And all of you here, it's just been my joy. To be a part. And anyway, so tonight's message is, and just to show you the kind of humor God has, it's on Crossroads, okay? It is Principle 7 and Step 10 together, all right? So I'll give you the fill in the blank, but as some of you got to know me and as I teach, this is borrowed. This is not something I made up. The reason there's notes in the back. So I'll tell you to turn it over, and this is no for you. It's your choice whether or not to write it down, but these are some things that both I've got insight on that I felt that I feel you should know about, but it's really your choice whether or not to write it down. So that you'll have a set of notes that will have some things in the back, and in the front, you just have the acrostic filled out, okay? And I tend to give them as I come up on them. So some who teach just gives you all at once, and I feel like the best way to teach it is to do it one at a time. So the first one is, first of all, let's read it. We read it together already, so let me read it real quick. Principle 7, reserve a daily time with God for self-examination, Bible reading, and prayer, in order to know God and His will for my life and to gain the power to follow His will. Step 10, the accompanying step, is we continue to take personal inventory, and when we're wrong, promptly admitted it. And the scripture that goes along with it that we all read is, so if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. 1 Corinthians 10:12, that's the New International Version. Okay, in our book, and I encourage all of you to pray about being a leader. Don't wait for Jimbo and Miss Vicky to approach you. okay, Ballin told you. really pray about it, and that's what it is. This is my second copy of it. I have one that was handed to me by the Bakers. So this one they handed me by Jimbo, and I'll be handing it back. It's not mine to keep, it's to pass on, so this might have someone's name on it out there already. Those of you listening to it might as well. Okay, so it's called Crossroads. It's lesson 19, and as you can see, there's 25 lessons that we teach, right? We do a lesson, we do a testimony. A lesson, testimony, to get you through the whole year. That's the whole thing, man. So the good news, guys, is that we're lesson 19. You know, do the math. We're almost done. So that's how you do it. You pace yourself. If I can tell you anything after, well, I said 12 years, is that you pace yourself. And you take it literally a day, a moment in time. But also, you just, you know, what is it I told a brother earlier? And it's something that we need to take to heart as addicts, as folks in recovery. And that is, it's about progress, not perfection. Amen. Will you relapse? It's not a question of if, but it's a question of when. It's how you get up. Okay, hear from me that has done it enough and will continue to do it. Get up. Okay, so that's what the Crossroads Principle 7 is about. So I want to share a couple of things off topic a bit. You know, anyone heard of the movie Crossroads? There's two of them out there now. You can Google it later on. Okay, so one of them is Crossroads. Remember the movie Karate Kid? I'm a big Karate Kid fan, right? So Ralph Macchio did a musical version of Crossroads, okay? And it's about a young blues player. So it has the same thing as Karate Kid. A young blues player who wants to be this next great blues player. And he finds kind of the Mr. Miyagi of blues, but he's a harp player. His name's Willie Brown, in the movie at least, okay? So this is all founded on the real Crossroads. Ever heard of Robert Johnson? Again, you can Google it. You might want to write some of these names back in your notes. But the movie Crossroads is about this young guy who sells his soul to the devil to be the next rock star. Okay? And it's founded on the actual song written by Robert Johnson in 1920. Okay? He supposedly did. He died a mysterious death, so it adds to the whole thing of him selling his soul. The name of the song is called Crossroads. Let me read you the first line in the song. And some of you 70s rockers may, or 60s rockers, and I can date myself, remember Cream, Eric Clapton. Well, they covered that, and they wrote their version of it called Crossroads. But it's a different version. This is the original version. Let me read you the lyrics. I went down to the crossroads, fell down on my knees. Down to the crossroads, fell down on my knees. I asked the Lord for mercy, and take me if you please. So you read the verses, it's a tortured soul. He's wanting to get relief. So the movie Crossroads that I told you about earlier, that Ralph Macchio from Karate Kid is in, they took that theme, the actual song from Robert Johnson, and the whole thing about the movie is kind of cool, is that Willie Brown, that's mentioned in this song, I'm sorry to take so much time, but I'm setting up really what the whole lesson is about, being at crossroads. He tries to get his soul back from the devil. So he literally goes back to Georgia, goes back to that crossroads, and calls on the devil and say, hey, I want my soul back. And the devil says, no, sorry. And he says, but I'll take this young man's soul. What do you gamble? So Ralph Macchio goes up there in place of his mentor, Willie Brown, the harp player who gave his soul and wants to get it back. And so the contest is between the devil's guitar player and Ralph Macchio. You got to get the movie and see the ending. Pretty awesome. Anyway, so other than that, someone tried to do another version of it. I haven't seen it. I read a couple things about it, but Britney Spears has an actual biography called Crossroads. And it's literally about the people that influence her life. So what is this all about? Guys, I'm at a crossroads. I'm going to share it with you, okay? At the age of 20, I took a public works job. And there's a whole litany to that. But here I am 50 years later. I never thought I would be working in the field that I have been blessed with. It's been a wonderful career of 50 years. But I blink and I can think of all the people, both good and bad, that have influenced my walk in public works. I'm a civil engineer by education and trade. But Jimbo can tell you, he's been part of my journey here in North Topsail before I hung it up. It's not an easy road, but God's been there all the way. And that's what I wanted to stress with you on the crossroads and why Lesson 19 is called that. And so let me also, this is something on the flip side of your notes, you can write these down. Crossroads is defined as being a stage in life. How's that stage of life? I know you are at your point right now. So these crossroads that you're at are at is a stage of life. And now let me tell you some of the characteristics of it is that you are facing, like I am, you're in an uncomfortable indecision state. You don't know if where you're going to go is really the step you ought to go. So you're in an uncomfortable state of uncomfortable indecision. It's defined by the fact that whatever you do, there are these moments that will decide what your future and other futures are going to be like. So there's these deciding moments. There are also these turning points. I can look back 50 years ago that the turning point for me, whether or not I would be here today, because I wanted to be an architect, I actually turned my application in at the wrong place. I did. Where I turned it in was a Parks and Rec place. You know, that poor clerk took it and somehow God put mercy in her heart. She said, that poor kid. And I had long hair. I was, you know, all I was wanted to do was surf at the time. And I was in a hurry dropping off because I wanted to go hit the surf. She took that application, drove it 2 miles down to City Hall where I had applied. She said, that's where he's applied, and dropped it off there. And I was one of six out of over 300 applications.
Wow.
What are the chances of that? It changed my life. And so that was a turning point. I look back on it now and all the things that have since happened have been that. So crossroads for your journey here at CR is the same thing. As a martial artist, we would always gauge when someone was at what we call the middle of the ranks. Most of the rankings were colors, right? And we called it, in my style, I have two black belts that I hold, and both styles are in the mid-rank, are blue belts. I would call it the blue belt blues. What would happen at the blue belt blues when they got to the crossroads? Half would just drop off. They're just done. They just don't, I've learned enough already, or I can't do it anymore. All right, don't let that be your story here at CR, okay? Don't, because I have found that at this principle and at this point in my steps is where I saw a lot of my brothers not come back, okay? And sisters as well, unfortunately, where we concentrate on our brothers. And I'm talking about 12-step, not just, small group. All right, so I'll leave us some encouragements hopefully for you. So let's move on. All right, so if you could, did we read this one yet? We've read it before earlier.
Okay.
So, yeah, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to read, there are five questions that the big book asks you to ask, and I don't want to do this a little bit different. So Chris, if you can go up to the slide that says questions to ask. There, go back there. So, the first question, what good did I do today? Go back to that first scripture. Okay,
So that first scripture is, yes, so that's, no, that's the second scripture.
Yeah.
First one, so
back
if you think,
more.
So if you think, yeah, so let's read that together. So if you think you are standing firm,
be careful that you don't fall.
First Corinthians 12. Okay, so that first question asks, again, don't go to a priest, I'll just read it from here, is what good did I do today? So that's the other thing, too, is we tend to get cocky. Now, we'll use that term, overconfident. Okay, you think, and that comes in a lot of different ways. You see a sister or a brother that struggles in an area, you got it. What's wrong with that? And that's being overly confident in yours, because that will come back on you. The enemy hears that and knows that as well. Don't think that you're hiding anything, okay? So what good did I do today? So that's the scripture. Before we read the next scripture, go back to that slide, and we'll read the second question, Chris. Oh, there it is. In what areas did I blow it today? Okay, so you're asking that yourself. Let's go back to the scripture. That would be the second one. And so let's read it together. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. John 8:32. You know in your heart of hearts when you blow it. You just do. And if you don't, you're only fooling yourself. It's what Jimbo and others have, you know, heard that old corny phrase, you're in the state of denial, and that's not a river in Egypt, right? You are. You're getting yourself, a failure, and you're getting in that area of arrogance. Remember that's the AA group I told you that I didn't want to be a part of, because I'm part of a group that does SA and AA, and it's not Alcoholics Anonymous. It's angry and arrogant. Okay, let's not do that. And that goes female and male, right? Let's not be AAs. Alrighty, next question. Question 3 says, did I do or say anything that hurt anyone today? Next scripture.
I am the way, the truth, and the life.
No one comes to the Father except for me.
Remember that time when, John 14:6. Remember when Jesus was talking to the disciples, and I don't exactly know what the book is in, I think it's in a couple, but you'll remember it, where he says, if you've seen the Father, if you've seen me, there are one, how can I see the Father? And so it's the same thing with that question that it's asking yourself. And these are questions that you ask you, okay? Donna asks Donna, you know, Lee asks Lee, and no one's asking it of you, but you're asking yourself. Did I do or say anything that hurt anyone today? And only you can answer. You know that. Your wife, your significant other, your child, your co-worker. Okay? Even yourself. Okay, that's the one I think that I'll put a pause button on this, that we are so tough in recovery is on ourselves. Look in the mirror and say, you're okay. You know? I was sharing this with a brother earlier in Psalms, it talks about that we're Psalm 119, where he says, wherever I go, you are there. In the deepest pits, you are there. In the highest, you are there. In the mountaintops. Well, even there, in the state of our addiction, he is there. So you're not fooling anyone when you don't look in that mirror and you're trying to hide. Think, oh, I'm really pretty awesome. You know, no. So be honest with yourself. Next one, question is, and I'll read it. Oh, no, you'll do it. Do I owe anyone amends? So from here, it's a progression. I did wrong something. All right, it says, so do I owe anyone? The scripture then, Chris? So if you think you are standing firm,
be careful
that you don't fall.
First Corinthians 10:2.
Again, that's going back to that false sense of security that you feel, that you're building up now. I come from a time in the Jesus Revolution day that we had a pastor at all, and he had a really good build too back then. And he would do this, and man, that muscle would pop up. And he was making a point, and he'd go, we're relying on this, brothers and sisters. And that's not what it's about as a walk in a Christian. Right? And so he's really making a point. You have to realize the Holy Spirit, what he's doing in your life. And that it's nothing that we have done. It's not anything that we're doing, but what he's already done and the rest in that. Okay. All right. So, Chris, we go back now after the scriptures. Is slide that says the what, the why. Okay, so part of this is taking our personal inventory. And the reason why, I'll pause and say, the reason that I think a lot of people the martial arts stop because the body starts to tell them they can't do certain things. And that's okay. Some are too old, some are just not limber enough, or they really feel like, you know, they've done enough to learn the martial arts. And then the others who say, this is not it, I'm gonna finish off, are the ones that something's burning in their gut to finish. And that's where I think we need to be in recovery, is that we need to push on and not be satisfied with where you've been. The key to that is the personal inventory. So that's what we need to do. The why is when we were wrong, okay, that helps us to put a purpose behind our why, okay? So in the back of your notes, if you could, write those down. What is the inventory? Why? Because it personalizes it, you know, or wrong. And then the big book calls it then what. I like to call it the how. You know, it really is how. We promptly admitted it. So there's a key word in there, it was we promptly. So put in, instead of then what, put how. So what is inventory? Why? Because we're wrong. And how? We do it. We do it now. And you know, I carry around this corny Nike thing. What is their swish move? It's do it. Just do it. Okay? This little symbol for me has helped me get through my years here at CR. Just do it. Just come and have a meal. Even if you're just going to have a meal, you're not going to stay for a small group. Just come. Next thing you know, you're staying for a small group. I'm going to go this time. I'm going to stay for a small group. You go, you stay for a small group. Next time, you might be healthy. You know, just build on it. Just do it. Just commit. That's what these chips are for. Just say, you know what? I'm going to come to it. I'm going to come once a month. Make it that. It's just between you and God as far as saying that this is my commitment. All right? All right. So, next slide. Okay. All right. Let's talk about the inventory. In my life, things happen in threes. It's weird. I have three children, my three. I also have three stepchildren, okay? I have three marriages. That's not something I'm proud of, but three marriages, okay? I also carry around three journals. And just something I'm just going to pass on to you, okay? A journal doesn't have to be everything that it is. So my three journals that I carry are for here, CR things, okay? They're for emotional things, things I really am feeling and whatnot. And then the professional things, things I need to do, the to-do. So these inventories, these daily things, make, you know, put a purpose behind them. Again, for me, I have three of them. Okay, I get it. And there's also three things of why you don't do it, because these are mine. I call them the three T's, okay? It's tedious, right, to write it down. I don't know about you, but I have to write. If I write too fast, it's hieroglyphics. I can't even read what was thinking, right? So you got to take time. The second thing is it's time consuming. I get that. All right? And the last thing, it's tiring. Sometimes it's at the end of the day, I'm like, I don't need to do this. Here's a hint. I keep one by my bed. So before I go to sleep, I'll just grab and just take a couple of notes. Jimbo yelled at me. I hate that guy. You know what I mean? You just make little notes, and that's what the inventory is about. Just doing it. Just doing it. You get in the habit of doing it, and before you know it, you're doing it more often than you should. Okay? I'm a nut on reading books because I think other than the Bible, which is the number one book that's read, there's also gifted writers. One is Dallas Willard, and he's written a ton of books. And the one that I'm just finishing up called The Spirit of Discipline. Let me read you one section out of it. It says, there's no quick fix. The one lesson we learn from all available sources is that there's no quick fix for the human condition. The approach to wholeness for humankind is a process of great length and difficulty that engages all our own powers to their fullest extent over a long course of experience. But we don't like to hear this. We are somewhat misled by the reports of experiences by great spiritual leaders, and we assign their greatness to these great moments that they were given, neglecting the years of slow progress they endured before them. Francis de Sales wisely counsels us not to expect transformation in the moment, though it is possible for God to give it. The ordinary purification and healing
whether of the body or the mind, takes place only little by little, by passing from one degree to another with labor and patience. And here's what I found interesting in his commentary. The angels upon Jacob's ladder had wings, yet they flew not, but ascended and descended in order from one step to another. The soul that rises from sin to devotion may be compared to the dawning of the day, which as it approaches, Chris knows as he sees the sun rises, does not expel darkness instantaneously, but little by little. Mm-hmm. And so with that, that's how we need to take it on our inventory. It doesn't have to be all inclusive. Just do it. Okay? Again, my hands carry a couple. All right. Then the scripture that said it, say it. Let us examine our ways and test them. Let us return to the Lord. Lamentations 3:4. Okay, slide. We'll pass that. Okay, we're going to go to E. So that's the first fill-in. All right? Or did I miss the first? The first one was take time to do personal inventory. I'm sorry, I missed that. So fill that in. And the second fill-in for this acrostic of 10 is evaluate. So we're at evaluate the good and the bad parts of the day. So as you're doing your inventory, you know, it's about progress, not perfection. And again, look in the mirror. Don't beat up on yourself, okay? We are our own worst enemy. I get it. And so try not to do that in your recovery. It is a natural tendency, okay, that you're worse off than we really are. So as a martial artist, I got around some symbols. And you all know about the yin and yang, right? You've seen that. That's simple. Let me share a couple of things with you. They're supposed to mean balance, and they're part of the Tao philosophy. I don't want to retain it, but I'm just sharing some background that it comes from a legitimate space, and it's practiced as long as Judaism. So it's been around a long time. Okay, so this is human thought that's been around. So the yin and yang, just so you know, yin, Y-I-N, you might want to write this in notes if you want. Mm-hmm. It's the black part. Okay, yang is the white part. They're supposedly, they are balanced, and they are they're linked. They are part of a cycle. You don't have more than the other. That's really bad. And I think that's biblical. Even in a goofy way, they saw it just as God has. He has everything in perfect balance, okay? Same thing with our the way we do our inventory is don't beat up on yourself. It has balance, okay? So, coincidentally, of the four principles, guess what number three is? There's number three again. Okay? Balance. There's balance. Okay? Balance. So previously, you'll remember, go back if you haven't, look at principle four. You know what that word, you know what it is? It's balance. Principle four is about balance in our daily inventory. We need to have that so we don't unnecessarily beat up. Next slide is our scripture. Let's say it. If we say that we have no sins, we are only fooling ourselves and refusing to accept the truth. We are lying and calling God a liar, for he says we have sinned. 1 John 1:8-10. Again, that's the Living Bible translation. All right, again, we talked about progress, not perfection, right?
Amen.
And as I like to say, and as I heard on my side, as being part of accountability teams, and former sponsor, not a sponsor right now, and that is three steps forward, right? And two steps back is still what?
One step ahead.
Take it. And for you to go three steps forward, three steps back, yeah, well, that's a major thing, but we're all here for us. We understand. No one's going to say, call Chris or Jimbo or Lee or anyone and say, listen, I really messed up, man. I went like three steps back. You know, I only took two steps forward. Well, that's a net minus, brother. What you up to? No, we're not going to do that. You know, we just want you to be honest with yourself so that you're able to get healed up and move forward. Okay, next slide. Whoever lives by the truth comes into the light. John 3:21. Okay, so again, no coincidence, but I picked up this book before I retired, before I even knew I was going to be teaching this. Okay? Crossroads.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. This is author Paul Young, who wrote the book and the movie that followed, The Shack. Okay?
Oh, that was
and so, anyway, I just picked it up because I'm a cheapskate. I went to a secondhand store. I said, well, it's in the dollar quarter section, you know. And I saw the title. It didn't mean anything to me. I just saw it. And I saw who it was, and I picked it up. Little did I know that God had something there for me, some crossroads. So, in this book, it's a great book that talks about redemption, okay? And it has a lot to do with being at the crossroads. When you take a certain route, it can mean no bueno, right? Mm-hmm. And it can also mean blessing. And so that's kind of sobering. So I'm going to, at the head of each chapter, there's a quote from real people. So believe it or not, again, only God can do something like this. And one of the chapters is from a guy, you can Google him, right? You want to write that in the back too. This is a real life blues man. He's one of the first blues men ever recorded in history, right behind Robert Johnson, named Blind Willie McTell. M-C-T-E-L-L.
Really?
Okay, Blind Willie McTell. And he had this quote, and I'll tell you why Blind Willie McTell is so important today. He wrote in here this quote, "I read the Bible often. I tried to read it right. As far as I can understand, it's nothing but a burning light." It's a blues song that he wrote, and that blues song is covered by the Allman Brothers. It's in the song "Statesboro Blues." You pull out one of the Allman Brothers' hits. Bob Dylan was so enamored with Blind Willie McTell that he wrote a line in one of his songs that says, "You can't sing blues like Blind Willie McTell." So, again, you know, part of the inventory is that you need to do something with it. God put it on your heart to get through your hand, to write it down for a reason. Okay? And there's people you need to make amends to. There's people you need to really, there's a hurt there. There's a hang up. All right? There's a habit that God's trying to speak to you about. I can say this to this day. That's what happens when I'm writing it down. I'm like, you know, show me the purpose. Show me why you put this on my heart and in my mind to write it down. All right, next slide. Okay, this is the last fill-in. It's the need to admit our wrongs promptly. So when you do the journaling, and you're writing, from the journals comes your inventory. That's the other thing, too. Your inventory, you're just not going to sit down to a list. I don't know, maybe you're a normal list. Some people go, Al screwed up here, Al is this. You're going to pull it from your journal. You're going to read your journal. This is what I need to write in my inventory. So that's why journals are helpful. They help you develop your inventory. But it's a way to document things that are going on. You guys know the term "for the record," right? You hear that all the time. You hear the movies, you hear the TV. But there's a legal reason they say "for the record." Okay, there's two things. As someone with a little bit of legal background, not like in the public realm, is that you say that, attorneys say that, people say that in public hearings so that they can do two things. Number one, they make it public so that everyone hears it for the record. Okay, and the second thing, they make it official. By doing that, they have date stamped it. This is when I said, this is where I said it, and whoever was here can attest to it. Yeah, I'll send it. So that's the two things. So that's what you're doing, okay? And look at it as, here goes the three again, that you're doing it with the Holy Spirit, with Jesus, and with God the Father. Those three are witnessing what you're saying, okay, this is what I need to, this is what I need to work on. So the word here, the operative, guys, and the takeaway for tonight's lesson in the inventory and doing this that I wanted to stress that I've learned this promptly. So the next scripture defines what biblically is promptly. Let's read it.
This is how I want you to conduct yourself in these matters. If you enter your place of worship and about to make an offering, you suddenly remember a grudge a friend has against you. Abandon your offering, leave immediately, go to this friend and make things right. Then, only then, come back and work things out with God. Matthew 5:23-24.
That's the message version. So, promptly. Mm-hmm. Don't let it fester. Don't let it sit. So the last thing I want to leave, did you get my, you didn't get the thing?
No.
Okay, sorry. All right, so what I asked was a moment of slide, and I'll just describe it to you. You can look it up, maybe write that in your notes. But you can Google it, there's all kinds of pictures of it. The artist Rembrandt, okay, he did this historic painting in 1690 called The Return of the Prodigal Son. And the reason I wanted to bring this up, and the fact that I have waited on amends, I have waited on things I've done on my inventory, only to regret why I didn't do them sooner. No one passed away. It wasn't one of those kind of sober moments. It's just that it got worse. You know, if I had done it then, it would have been so much better than the people that I was trying to reach out to, that I know that I need to get healed of that hurt. All right. Again, it says the qualifiers that would hurt them or others. So you want to try to check that out. But the ones that I have failed in is when I waited too long. So the biblical definition of promptly, you can see it right there. All right. It means right away. It means whatever you're doing, stop. Go do it. All right. So the thing about the prodigal son, let me read you one thing. The last thing that I want to reference is this book, The Road to Daybreak, a spiritual journey that I've been reading. Anyway. My source is this, and I'll paraphrase. Okay. In it, it describes the return of the prodigal son painting by Rembrandt. And it got into some pretty cool details about it. But the one thing I wanted to share with you about the return of the prodigal son, and I started reading about the prodigal son, we all know the story, right? But do you realize in proper context, I just realized it when I started to look at it, that it wasn't promptly that the prodigal son came back. Okay. When you look at it in context, how many years do you think it was? Well, according to most scholars, it was decades. It was decades. So even if you crank, you put on there 20 years, let's say, maybe it was 30. The picture, when you look up Rembrandt's picture, it shows a beat up person. He had one shoe on, or else the other foot that's showing, but he's ragged. And his dad is old. Okay, and so it wasn't like, you know, just happened a month, a year, he was waiting, he saw him down the road. It was decades. How does someone have faith that they'll come back? That this son, after decades of just losing everything, would think, I'm gonna go back. So that's the sobering part about what we do and what our recovery is and how serious we should take it. We need to take it. Not that we want to beat ourselves up, but let's do it promptly. Let's do our recovery. Let's take it serious. Okay? Later on tonight, we're going to circle up. We're going to pray and at the end of the Lord's Prayer, where I was taught, all the saddlebacks, we always finish it with, it works if you work it, and if you won't, if you don't. And that's really the bottom line, folks. Everything that the Bakers laid out in this program, this wonderful program called Celebrate Recovery, is got to work. It works if we work it, it won't, if you don't. And there's nothing magic to it. There's no voodoo, you know, that causes it to just kind of happen. It's up to us to get into our part of it. So thank you again for allowing me to be part of this Celebrate Recovery. And aloha ke kua.
Thank you, Al.